Hallelujah. He is a great God. Amen. Amen. Tonight I want to again return to our study we've been doing. Matter of fact, this is the 10th of the series, Healing Mind, Body, and Soul. Tonight I'm going to do the first of what are two pieces on negative soul ties. It's so much to do here that I'm going to put it in two parts, but it's still a part of the entire series. But negative soul ties will take up two portions to get it all out. Genesis chapter 34 is where we'll start. So if you get your Bibles, get to Genesis 34. And then when we finish there, well, we'll add to it 2 Samuel 13. So Genesis 34 and then 2 Samuel 13. And I'm talking tonight about negative soul ties. Beginning at verse 1. Now Dinah, the daughter of Leah, whom she had born to Jacob, went out to see the daughters of the land. And when Shechem, the son of Hamor, the Havite, prince of the country, saw her, he took her and lay with her and violated her. His soul was strongly attracted to Dinah, daughter of Jacob, and he loved the young woman and spoke kindly to the young woman. So Shechem spoke to his father Hamor, saying, "Get me this young woman as a wife." Jacob heard that he had defiled Dinah, his daughter. Now his sons were with his livestock in the field, so Jacob held his peace until they came. I want to talk again this negative soul tie issue. That text almost belies the wickedness of the situation. And so let me read that first couple of verses again in the Message, which I think gives a little bit clearer idea of what happened. The Message uses this way: one day Dinah, the daughter of Leah, had given Jacob, went to visit some of the women in that country. Shechem, the son of Hamor, the Havite, who was a chieftain, notice the word chieftain, hold that in your heart, there saw her and raped her. Then he felt a strong attraction to Dinah. Well, he fell in love with her and wooed her. Shechem went to his father, Hamor, "Get me this girl for my wife." Wow. You know, the idea tonight, one of the things that holds my attention is the fact that most people don't realize that there are several ways that soul ties happen, one of which is through the spirit of lust, sexual sins. Now I say one of which, and I need to be clear that sexual sins does not simply take in those times of personal intimacy with another individual. They also take in those intimacies of the mind. So that the Bible says that when a man looks upon a woman to lust after her, he's already committed adultery in his heart. Now, that means at least every man in here right now is an adulterer at least once. I'm sure you brothers up there don't know what I'm talking about, but. So that the act of the physical intimacy is the culmination of what happens in the mind. And since the soul tie is in the mind and is a part of the mind, one can have a soul tie without being physically intimate. But it is the lust, it is that burning passion on the inside that creates it. It creates what we have to realize is an invisible bond. An invisible bond, the like of which can be stronger than any chains around us. An invisible bond, the like of which that makes ropes seem like they're nothing. Because what happens is, once one has entered a soul tie, one begins to cling to a thing. and to even cleave unto it. You are now attached, locked in. And some of us know that there are certain people in our lives that we're just locked into. We're attached to. We realize it only after the fact. There's a part of them that's in you. And what is really troubling about it is that we share, because we will accept these soul ties in our life, we end up sharing with them even their sin. We share with them even their wickedness or even their darkness. When we enter into soul tie with a person, all that they are becomes a part of us, because we have accepted them and tied ourselves into them spiritually. You have to know that sometimes when you and I enter relationships, we don't enter them with the idea that we're going to get caught up. Sometimes we enter relationship with the best of intentions. We enter them just simply looking for friendship, and friendship turns into foolishness. Friendship goes downhill real quick, and we lose our way. We begin to fall apart. We begin to enter into all kinds of things that we are not to be involved in. At times, promises are made, passions are inflamed, and before you know it, life for you is completely changed. And there's no accident that when you're in the middle of a soul tie relationship, manipulation and coercion are easy, because you want to maintain the relationship, so therefore you can be manipulated or coerced. And in some cases, some of us are the coercers. Oh, they can happen in a lot of ways. And not just, I'm talking about lust tonight, but you know, there are soul ties that come with many different kinds of relationships. You know, sometimes people you look up to, you end up binding yourself to them in a soul tie relationship, and they can end up manipulating you, even those saints of God who enter your life through spiritual kindness. Can end up manipulating you spiritually by using their gifts to now take control of your life, to manipulate who you are and where you are in God. You have to realize that an emotional bond is a bond. It is still a bond. And an erotic bond is a bond that is inflamed. Now, let's see how I put this to you. You have to know that with everything we do comes a spirit. There is a spirit of lust. There is a spirit of sexual eroticism. There is a spirit that goes along with it, and those spirits tend to cling to us. And let me help you here. Those spirits also come and they fall under the umbrella of witchcraft. I know people don't want to talk about witchcraft, but it's real. Witchcraft, evil spirits. Sometimes people want to be so involved with you that they will go through the lowest, nefarious means in order to have themselves attached to your life. Many years ago, I was in school in Selma, Alabama. And I was in a dorm room, and it was a room set up for three, but there was only two of us in there. My roommate was a pastor, and he was only there a couple days during the week because he went back to his church. And so I'm in this room, and one day I come back to my room, and somebody's been in my room. I know he hasn't been there because he's already back taking care of his church. And I go to my shirts. At that point, I was hanging my shirts up, and, you know, nice folded, nice iron shirts, what I'm saying. And I went to my shirts, and there at the tail end of my shirts, right here that comes down, was a spot on each of the tail end of my shirts in the front. So that when I put my shirt, tucked it in my pants, whatever that was they were praying over would be right next to my genitals. That spirit of witchcraft that wanted to create a soul tie, apparently I was not paying them enough attention, and they went down to Madame Beelzebub and got something. Listen, that spirit of witchcraft caused them to go out of their way to try to put something on me to cause and force me into an attraction that I did not have. Don't fool yourself. Some of you deacons will be able to tell that. I remember one time when I first became pastor here many, many years ago, and it would take Chairman's story. I wish God who could be allowed to tell you this story. I became pastor, and I was leading and trying to lead church. I had not met my wife by that time. And a woman called here to talk to me. Well, it started out that we got a call from a hall here where they were setting up for my wedding. Yeah, they were setting up for my wedding. And a woman called, and she was all excited and getting ready for the big day and planning and making all kinds of wedding celebratory plans and getting her stuff together. And her mother called because her mother wanted to know, you know, what my intentions were. She hadn't had a chance to really spend any time with me. I said, ma'am, I said, I'm sorry, but I don't even know your daughter. I don't know who you are. I don't know what's going on here. She said, but you asked my daughter. Well, ma'am, I'd have to know her to ask her. I don't know her. But dude, we made all these plans. We're getting ready. Her soul had knitted so to the image that she saw in me, because not the person, that she thought that I was as in love with her as she was with me. She believed that thing was going to work. I guess she, you know, sometimes someone said, if you believe it, you know, walk around three circles or give an offering in this time and God's going to splash some holy water in. Well, that thing was a whole mess. So I was trying to deal with it. I was on the phone. I was trying to explain myself. And Chairman Story was sitting in the office at that time. He said, give me that phone, boy. See, you know only Deacon Story could do what he did. I can't repeat everything he said. But needless to say, I was bothered with that no more. It is interesting that we fail to realize the spirits that come with these ties. You know, you want to catch a hold of this tonight, because one of the ways, and I'm going to talk about characteristics of soul ties, negative soul ties in a moment, but one of the ways you definitely know that you happen to be into a midst of a soul tie is when you lose your individuality, when your identity gets wrapped up in the other person. When they start making decisions for you, you can't make a decision for yourself. Something wrong. Something just ain't right. Hello? You have to recognize God did not, I don't care if God gave you a relationship with a husband and God put a man in your life, thank God for it. He wants a whole woman, not a half a woman. Hello? He doesn't want a woman to lose her mind at home because she's trying to follow his. No. The Bible says you're supposed to be a helpmeet. Amen? And you can't help me if you can't help yourself. You have to know that anything, any relationship you're in that steals your identity, your individuality, that steals your independence from you, that takes from you that instinct of self, where you don't know who you are anymore, is a negative relationship. Any relationship you're in that you feel like you don't have any more confidence, or you're looking for their approval in order to live, that's not a positive situation at all. If it throws you out of whack, that's not a positive. You know, when you get near somebody, it ought not to make you nervous to be in their presence. Hello? I wanted the test of love, and we use this with people, and when folks want to get married, they come see me and I talk to them. And one of the tests of love happens to be this. Does your relationship give you energy, or does it take energy from you? If being in your presence saps all my joy, then you may be a sap sucker. I got to be careful of you. Let me tell you. I have to know that the lust that I may walk in is going to be based on something. Sometimes it's based on a visual experience. Sometimes it's something I've seen. So, you can see someone or something and really enter into a thought relationship with it, him or her. So I've got to be careful about what visual experiences I have. I also have to be careful about what visceral enticements I get into. See, some stuff I can see and I can say, man, that's fine. But sometimes I see that says, hot diggity dog, good golly, Miss Molly. See, you may know something is nice and it doesn't speak to you. Yeah, can I use food as an example? Because I don't want anybody to get unnerved in here. I can already tell I've made you a little anxious already. So you could like steak. Someone could put the best piece of fish in front of you there is. It doesn't move you. But if you like steak, they can put chuck roast out. And you'll get excited. And so you have to be careful to guard that which you see, because it can create a visceral, internal excitement in you that creates an enticement that induces you to engage in that which the enemy would want you to, which might be unseemly, that which in your body. Sometimes you have to know that it is essential for us that we keep our lives in a certain way, because we will be burdened. This is important. You can become burdened by the need for gratification. Let me say it again. You can become burdened by the need for gratification. That's what makes shopaholics. That's what makes folk run from relationship to relationship. They get burdened by the need for gratification. And any relationship that doesn't meet that need is disposable. Okay. I have tonight some things, and I believe there are six of them. Six characteristics I want to develop tonight with you that I think will help you to see what I refer to here as a negative soul tie. If you don't know that which you're involved in is negative, then you look at these six things. If you see any of these characteristics in your relationship, then you know something you need to be looking at and trying to get out of. Amen? Number one, a negative soul tie may have the characteristic of imbalance caused by powerlessness. Imbalance caused by powerlessness. A healthy relationship ought to be balanced, ought to have mutual benefits associated with it, ought to be something uplifting and progressive, ought to be something that you can find your spiritual equilibrium in. If a relationship is imbalanced, meaning there's a hierarchy already set up, then you have to be very wise about that. You know, one of the things, if we think about our study from last week, one of the things that Jonathan does immediately is he takes away the imbalance between their wealth right away by giving unto David, so that David now he balances the scales immediately. What you'll look at these texts that we're looking at here tonight, you'll see how the imbalance is there. Well, the Bible tells you that you are not to be unequally yoked. And one of the things it says, with what? Unbelievers. So there can be an imbalance just based on the fact that we don't both believe the same thing. If you're in love with someone that's not in love with Jesus, Houston, we have a problem. And in this case here, this is an imbalance based on powerlessness. And why do I say that? In the text we just read about Shechem, the son of Hamor, the Bible says this of him, that he was a prince of the country. He was in a power position. And if the power position of being a prince was not enough, he was a man in a patriarchal society that took maleness as more important than femaleness. So that this woman was stuck in a very powerless situation. So much so that when he desired her against her wishes, the Bible says he overpowered her. He took it. He did what he wanted to do. Now, he did that while being, the Bible says, his soul clinged to her. But scripture is clear that he took her and laid with her and violated her. Powerlessness there. Well, in the case of Tamar, the Bible says in 2 Samuel chapter 13, verse 14, This boy went ahead, and he says, after she tried to plead with him, however, he would not heed her voice, and being stronger than she, he forced her and lay with her. He forced her and lay with her. Now, in these two negative soul ties that we're dealing with today, these are both rape by any other way you want to put it. These are not a normal, social, sensual, sexual relationship. So don't get me, don't try to think I'm trying to say that all these relationships that happen in that way are, no. What I'm simply using is this as an illustration of what happens. The power imbalance caused him to believe that he could take control over the individual that was powerless. And trust me, it is not all male to female, where the female is the powerless one. Sometimes the female is the powerful one taking control of the powerless male. Without being too crude, and it might be a little crude, I'm looking over here, Sister Good, to help me out, but she's not giving me any word. We used to say that he's whipped. You get it on the way home. What'd you say, D? Got his nose wide open? His nose so wide open the truck could go in sideways? Y'all know what I'm talking about. Whenever you're in a relationship where there is imbalance caused by powerlessness, you have to check that relationship because it is probably a negative relationship towards your life. And let me tell you something. If you get in that same relationship where it's imbalance caused by powerlessness and the other person is just as submissive, it's just as bad. Because if somebody only wants to be dominated and controlled, it's just as bad as if they were being controlled because someone was taking advantage of them. Number two, it is indifference caused by privilege. Indifference caused by privilege. Now, in this case, the privilege is male to female. It is wealth to non-wealth. It is strength versus weakness. But a lot of things are privilege in the fact that they have access to you or they have entered into a relationship with you, and now they take from the individual all that they are because they're indifferent to the feelings of the other person. They don't care about you. They don't care how you feel. They don't care that whatever that happened made you cry, or you went down, or you were messed up. They don't care that you have a lack of peace, or that your body is now aching because you don't feel good in their presence. They don't care. And trust me when I tell you this, domination comes in many forms. Sometimes it's intimidation, but other times it's intimacy. Sometimes it's criticism, but other times it's courtesy. Sometimes it's a promise, other times it's passion, sometimes it's guilt, and other times it's gifts. Domination can come in many ways. Because of their indifference, based on the privileged position they're in your life, they don't care that you messed up. You know, ain't nothing like somebody watching you cry and could care less whether you cry or fall down on your head. So what you crying? I got needs too. So what you got? I got problems too. Indifference is almost worse than somebody being upset. I almost rather you be mad at me than be indifferent towards me. Because in the midst of indifference is that feeling that I don't count. I don't measure up. I don't matter. And trust me, that indifference is a spirit that rests on people that causes them or allows them to manipulate others, because the person that wants the relationship the most is the one most vulnerable to the spirit of indifference. Let me say it again. The person that wants the relationship the most is the one most vulnerable to the spirit of indifference. So whoever could care less becomes powerful in any relationship. Number three. It is instability caused by passion. Instability caused by passion. You know, whenever you get hot and bothered and get all lathered up, whenever your thermometer goes off the scale, whenever you start feeling anxious, whenever you go cuckoo for Cocoa Puffs, you have to know it causes instability. Hello? You know, and there's some folk know how to tweak us. They know how to say that right thing. They know how to take us right back. Woo! Take me back. Take me back, dear baby, to the place where I... Never mind, y'all. Listen, you have to be kept, because in that passion creates an instability where you would have been strong. Now all of a sudden the enemy has your mind. Okay. The first 2 Samuel chapter 13. I've been glancing over it, so let me just use it for a moment here. For those of you who don't know this story, I'll read the first four verses from the Message Bible. Sometime later, 2 Samuel 13, this happened. Absalom, David's son, had a sister who was very attractive. Uh-oh. Her name was Tamar. Amnon, also David's son, was in love with her. Uh-oh. This is a stepbrother in love with his stepsister. Now, you know that's a whole mess. And look what the text says. And was obsessed with her. Well, I haven't talked about obsession yet. I will next week. But obsession is a dangerous thing. You get locked and loaded, you're in trouble. Hello? You enter into a fixation on any person or anybody, you are in a whole mess. Not a part of a mess, a whole mess. He was obsessed with her, with his sister Tamar, to the point of making himself sick. What? She was a virgin, so he couldn't see how he could get his hands on her. Amnon had a good friend, Jonadab, the son of David's brother Shimna. Jonadab was exceptionally streetwise. He said to Amnon, "Why are you moping around like this day after day? You the son of the king? In other words, you a person of privilege? You get to have whatever you like." What do you like? Whatever you like. Tell me what's eating at you. In a word, Tamar, said Amnon, my brother Absalom's sister, I'm in love with her. Instability caused by passion. I need to put this out there. Be careful what you become passionate about. Better still, I'll put it even bolder, be careful who you become passionate about. Amen? Because fixations and obsessions can turn into a mess. You can get so fixated on an individual that before you know it, you are unstable. And the Bible says the double-minded man is unstable in all of his ways. Number four. I'm going to make it tonight with all six of these before I close. Number four. It is insatiability caused by predilection. Insatiability caused by predilection. Let me do it this way. I can get something in my spirit that I have thought about, I've mused over, I've pondered, I got it all on me, it's in me to the point where nothing else will satiate it. Because it's not the act, it is the fulfillment of the predilection. It's the fulfillment of the thought. That's why grown folk, I put it up high. If you don't get it, ask somebody else on the way home. That's why you can find relational, physical pleasure that does not give you emotional pleasure. Because the body is only one aspect of the pleasure senses that you're working with. Because if it doesn't meet this up here, whatever happens down here doesn't matter. That's why Clef John said, it doesn't matter. So that insatiability is created not in my physical, it is created in my thought, therefore emotional, which is what makes the soul tie dangerous. Because if that soul tie holds on, guess what? Nothing will satisfy my need like the thing that I am fixated and obsessed on, because I am not trying to meet a physical need, I'm trying to meet an emotional need, which is filling a spiritual gap that I've allowed to come in because I fixated on something that was not of God. I've got to be careful. The enemy wants to tear your life down. And how's he trying to do it? By taking your thoughts and making your thoughts your enemies. Taking your thoughts and making your thoughts your enemy. Before you know it, you're dreaming about stuff. You daydreaming, night dreaming, visioning, blurred eye, seeing folk out the corner of your eye that's not even there. Before you know, you got ghosts right around you, including Casper. It's anything but the Holy Ghost. Here's what the text says. The text says this. This is the same, this is the Genesis 34 passage, Dinah Hamor. This is what he says. It says, then he felt, this is verses 1 through 4, I'm reading the Message Bible. Then he felt a strong attraction to Dinah, Jacob's daughter, fell in love with her and wooed her. Shechem went to his father, Hamor, get me this girl for my wife. He raped her and then fell in love with her. Or was it that he fell in love with her and then raped her? In any case, he has a strong attraction to her And the problem with this text is several. I'm not dealing with the text in perfect exegetical order, so forgive me if I don't give it all to you, but understand this. There's several problems with this text. One is the fact that he can rape her and then go to her daddy, go to his daddy, and then his daddy go to the other men, and then the men sit around and decide what to do with her body. Get her for my wife. What you gonna do for us? Well, we'll join y'all. Y'all circumcised, we'll be circumcised. You all are bargaining this girl's broken body. Violated, virgin girl, had not been touched by a man, and now the men are sitting around deciding her lifelong fate. Oh, there's some problem with the text. I'm just pointing them out to you. But his problem and ours is being careful, because what happens to us is that we can end up with an insatiability caused by a predilection. Number five. We can end up with an imagination caused by a prurience. Prurience. Now, the word prurience simply means lustful thought. Okay? You know what? One of the greatest gifts God ever gave to you? My mentor in my mind, and someone who I admire dearly, Howard Thurman, always calls the imagination the angelos of God, the angel of God. Because with it, I can see that which is not yet in my presence. I can visualize it. I can experience it. I can experience it so greatly as if I were physically present to it. And all you grown people understand exactly what I mean. Because of my imagination, I can become physically present to that which is not physically present with me. Because of my imagination, I can have a fulfillment and part of my physical flesh, because I allow my imagination to take off and run wild. And the lustful thoughts that are in my imagination become a part of my physical life, and there is an outpour from my flesh because I've let prurience of my mind run amok. You know what? If you don't guard your thoughts, preach, Pastor. Thank you so much. I'm trying. If you don't guard your thoughts, listen. 2 Samuel 13. I'm going back and forth between Dinah and Tamar, but 2 Samuel 13, verse 2 says this. It says, Amnon was so distressed over his sister Tamar, and he became sick, for she was a virgin, and it was improper for Amnon to do anything to her. He got sick physically because his mind was going crazy. He got sick physically because his imagination was running wild. Saints, you need to understand that if you don't keep your imagination in check, you could be in a whole mess without even trying. Don't fool yourself. I know some of y'all been saved a few days. I feel your anointment. Don't ever get to the point where you think you're above your own prurience. Don't ever get to the place where you say, well, I'm too old to think like that. Mm-hmm. Don't ever get to the place where you think, that's not going to happen to me. Oh, I'm saved, child. I've been saved so long, that don't cross my mind. The devil is a lie. And so are you. Oh, I got gray hair now, child. you know what the old folks said when I was young? It could be snow on the rooftop. But it doesn't mean there ain't no fire in the furnace. I'm trying to help folk tonight. Let me put it out. I'm putting it to you. You have to guard your thoughts. And don't act like I'm trying to be all that deep. I'm not trying to be deep. I'm not trying to act like I'm perfect. The devil is a lie. I'm trying to help us all reach with the goal that God has given us. Last one, number six, and I'm going to stop. I'm going to stop tonight. Number six, this is a part of what you have to know about these soul ties. It is interestedness with the idea of plunder. Interestedness with the idea of plunder. You know, folk will act like they all into you just to get what they want. They'll act like they're all into you. Ooh, baby, the sun and the moon shine on you. They'll Barry White talk to you. You'll never find another love like mine. Someone to love you like I do. Oh, I'm not bragging on myself, baby. But I'm the one to love you, and there's no one else. One else. Oh, they'll really get deep on you. Barry White said, practice what you preach. You keep telling me this and telling me that. Say once I'm with you, I'll never go back. You say there's a lesson that you want to teach. Well, here I am, baby. Notice, if you will, in the text, in each of their case, their interestedness was in order to get fulfillment for what they wanted. For what they wanted. Again, I'm going back to 2 Samuel 13, and I'm going to close with this. Now, Jonadab gives him the plan. Jonadab said to him, pretend that you are sick and go to bed. Your father comes to see you, say to him, please ask my sister Tamar to come and feed me. I want her to fix some food here where I can see her. And then serve it to me herself. So Amnon pretended that he was sick and went to bed. King David went to see him, and Amnon said to him, please let Tamar come in and make a few cakes here where I can see her. And then served him to me herself. Everybody that acts interested in you is not interested in you. They may only be interested in plundering what you have. Don't ever take interest from anyone to mean genuine affection or love. Because some folk are in relationship not for what they can give, but for what they can get. And when you're in a relationship with somebody that's taking from you and not giving to you, you know it's a negative soul tie. And you need to cut it off. The word of the Lord.